And it took me 2 grad schools to be able to write that. It was my thesis for Mount Royal, and I got it done, and I'm like, I just did 4 years so I could write this. I'm now happy with the deep, dark stuff in my work. And then that journal offered to publish it with some images of my thesis. And then another journal wanted it too, but you can't double publish something within 3 months of each other. But it was nice that someone else looked at that question. Mm-hmm. Alrighty. In my work, I like to incorporate the dangerous and the sublime to something fleeting, and especially something that's considered beautiful. In the 3 paintings up in this show, 2 sunrises in 30 days and Women's March on the Tidal Basin are both from this year. The other one, Dangerous Cliffs, I started around 2008 and I finished this year. I put painting down for about 5 or 6 years. And now my new studio is primed for painting, so I picked it back up. And this year is the first time my art is directly related to my own politics. I documented 25 sunrises in the first 30 days, from about Christmas to the inauguration, if you want to call it that. And I discovered in that process that winter sunrises are cold, and that the atmosphere makes for what I felt were different conflicts of colors. And I painted it with the memory of all those photos taken in my mind. I didn't actually reference them. And then the Women's March painting. I've never used so much pink in my entire life put together, seriously. It's below, they're 2 30 by 30 stacked up over there. And before the march, the idea for this painting flashed in my head. As the cherry blossoms are the one festival and tourist event that drives in about
crazy divorce. So people would joke, oh, it's like a Jerry Springer show. Ha ha ha, yeah, it's funny. But it wasn't funny, it was shocking and like, you know, earth shattering for everybody involved. So while going through that, one of my close friends was also dying of breast cancer. So I had the 2 weeks of shock and like not eating and trying to figure out what do you do, because I have 2 children with him. What do you do with the children with a person with like absolutely no regard for anyone but himself? How do you keep them safe? And he started drink and drive, and I had these 2 weeks of panicking. And then I saw my friend in her casket and I thought, okay, stop this shit. Snap out of it and, you know, be who you know you are. So through that, my therapy was painting. And I would paint for hours and hours and hours on end on my front porch. And my parents lived very close behind an alley behind my house. And they would drive by at like 3 in the morning, and I knew they had nowhere to go at 3 in the morning. They were just like, oh, I went to Sheets, and we decided to go out. And they'd circle the block and like wave at me. And I had Dave Matthews blasting, usually. My neighbors, I had complaints called in about me. And I'd just feverishly be painting, like, anger. And the very first painting I finished was, I named it Red Morning in Hell. And it was steeples that rose out of hell, and gargoyles and creatures crawling around. And I guess, you know, that's where he came from, and that's where she came from, in my mind. And I still really think that. But therapy for me was the art. And it was transformative in the way that it actually brought me back to who I've always been. And who I lost, you know, myself, and not because of my children, but really because of an emotionally abusive, restrictive, awful relationship. And at that point, I was just thrilled to be out. So it was like a 2 weeks of not eating and shock, and the only thing I could eat were Reese's Pieces for some reason. And then a couple of years of walking my ass off and painting like a nut, and remembering like, oh, yeah, this is what made me happy when I was a kid, if I was like upset about something at school, or just all the time, writing poetry and painting. And so it transformed me into who I used to be and who I, you know, should have been.
I'm a painter. I do mostly painting. Sometimes I dabble in other things, but I mostly do painting. And one of the things that Grace helped me to find within myself is, and I think you said this also, is you really have to find yourself in your painting, but not, you know, but it's not all paintings are autobiographical. I mean, most paintings have a universal nature to it, but they're not all autobiographical. So I've been doing this work since, you know, I graduated from MICA in 2001, and I've been doing it steadily since 2001 from what I call my true soul paintings, which have also evolved over the years. But let me just start off with this one. This painting is called Lacing Through Life and Death. Let me get the title exactly right. Lacing Life and Death, and it's inspired by a poem written by a poet named Janet Lewis. Janet Lewis lived from 1899 until about 1999. And her poems are deceptively simple. Let me put it that way. They're really, you look at them, you think they're mostly about nature. But when you read them a little bit more, they're really about questions of life, the meaning of life, mortality. Sometimes she has poems that speak directly to me, like, what am I doing with my life? I've got to clean the kitchen, you know, or something like, you know, all those kind of conflicts. Sometimes she has that kind of poem, but mostly her poems are about her life, everything that happened, the raising of children, the, you know, the garden that she worked on. This particular painting is based, because they're not illustrative. They're inspired by this poem called Meadow Turf. It's a very short poem, and I'll read it to you. Let's hope it is read well. Goldenrod, strawberry leaf, small bristling aster, all loose strife, knife-bladed grasses lacing their roots, lacing the life of the meadow into a deep embrace, far underground, and all their shoots wet at the base with shining dew, dry crested with sun, springing out of a mold years old, leaves living and dead, whose stealing odors on the cold bright air shed healing. Oh heart, here is your healing, here among the fragrant living and dead. So when I thought about that poem, and we all gone through this, we all had experiences of people that we love and they die, and yet there's birth. So it's the universal nature of life and death. But what came to my mind first was I smell dirt when I read this poem, and that I was explaining to my friends over there. It's the kind of dirt that's just turned over in the spring. The type of dirt that's ready to be replanted. So the references that I used in this poem was, actually this is references, an old painting of my son, my middle child, 30 years ago. and he was just on top of a rock, and he was, you know how that time of life around 4 years of age, you really do think the world is your oyster.
No.
You know? It's a wonderful feeling. It doesn't last long enough. You know? And I think he did. He really felt that. So he epitomizes life for me. But then there's all this dirt, all this growth, the lacing of all these things, little tiny creatures, and of course, a new cell, a new seed, you know, germinating. And maybe we don't see it. Maybe we just smell it. Maybe we just hope for it.
So I was leaving my parents and going to live in this institution with, in a way, it was like a college campus. There were dormitories, so I lived in the dormitory with children my age, probably. Maybe age 5 to 9. Basically, I looked look back on it, and there were, I have a lot of very fond memories. There were, I had friends all the time. There was always something to do. We went to public school, we went to school. But in the beginning, it was difficult to have left family and just your friends and your family. And so at night, I would end up crying. And we each had our own little cubicle. So I had the privacy of my own space, which was relatively small. We had one window. And so at night, in the beginning, I would cry. And outside of my window, there was a building across the grounds. And there was a single light bulb on that building. And when I cried, there would be rainbows around the light bulb. And so over time, I mean, you can't be homesick forever. And so I stopped crying, and then I realized that I missed the rainbow. And so then every once in a while, I would try to cry so that I could see the rainbow again. And now we're going to fast forward. You know, I went home. I outgrew this, the asthma, and I was home with my family, and I was very fortunate because I had a grandmother who liked to travel, so she took me on many trips. I got to see a lot of the world. I got to visit museums and be exposed to ancient cultures like the pyramids in Egypt. And then fast forward again, I got a degree in fine arts. I got a master's degree in sculpture. I had my kids, and then when my son was about, my youngest son, I had two sons, when the youngest one was five, he had just started kindergarten, which gave me my independence back. I no longer had all the obligations of my children for this certain period of time of day. So I started taking some art classes again. And within a few months, my father had become very ill, and we had to move him into our home. And I lost that independence, and I felt almost claustrophobic. And so what I did was I decided, I have to do something in art. I have to have this escape. And what can I do that is sculpture, because I have this degree in sculpture, what can I do that is sculpture that does not require bandsaws, that does not require heavy equipment, table saws, all of these different things. And so I came up with the idea of using mesh and paint and canvases. And that was how it got started. And over the course of experimenting with these materials, in the very beginning, I didn't really use paint. I started with one layer of mesh over, I may have painted the canvas, but I didn't paint the mesh. And then I thought, well, what if I tried two layers of mesh? And so I tried two layers, and I discovered in the process, not having been a scientist, I didn't realize this, that if you cross two layers of mesh, you can get moiré patterns, which I think are really interesting. And I guess what I would say is, this is what fascinates me. The phenomena in life that is there, that brings my attention, that draws my my desire to see what is going to happen if I do this. And so I experiment, and so all of these little things are ideas that I've experimented with. And in a way, I think it all ends up referencing that rainbow all that time ago.
To label myself, which you probably do nowadays, I labeled myself an eco-feminist, absolutely. I've always really, really cared about the earth, and especially the waters on the earth, and that became a lot more important when global warming happened, and the waters were both going to overtake the earth, but at the same time, that because of the rising temperature, that the glaciers melt. And then while I was doing a lot of this kind of photography, and it's something that I came up with, and basically I've been painting water, and when you have a wave of water, if you put your hand in the wave, it disperses to either side, so the wave is no more, right? Okay. If you go up in a plane, and no kidding, and I did this, you stick your hand outside the window of the plane, it was someone's private plane, but and you stick it in a cloud, the heat of your hand disperses the cloud, and it is no more, okay, it just disappears. Okay, same thing with light, and this is what happened with these photographs, that, and they're all chemical, there's no digital at all, there's no playing with them at all. This is a photograph of pure light. It's sunlight. And the thing is that what I'm doing should be impossible, because if you have a black round, it absorbs the colors. So this shouldn't be able to be happening. But I developed this process whereby you can see the prismatic light affected by sunlight with coming out of a black round. And everybody was sitting there and saying, oh my God, it looks like the cosmos, et cetera, et cetera. And I said, yeah, that's the point, because it is, you know, as if we're drawing out of a black galaxy, not a black hole, but the black unendingness of the galaxy that we have, all right? I was painting water and waves and icebergs, and I always had the polar bears stuck on the icebergs. And I couldn't figure it out till one day when my daughter came home. She'd been teaching and going to school in England, and she was, you know, a good 8 hours away by plane and train. And once she got sick and she couldn't get the NIH doctor, you know, fast enough, and she called me, and it was scary. And I realized, hey, you know, she's really far away, and I can't reach her, and I'm a mom, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So I realized why I was doing the polar bears. It was really weird, but I had these polar bears, and they were stuck on a glacier, and their mama bear was somewhere on the land that it had broken off from, and they were gonna die. I mean, you know, there was no way that they could forage for fish or anything like that, and mama was ways away, and there was a big ocean between them, just like there was a big ocean between me. I realized, you know what? That mama polar bear is no different than me. You know, we're all totally connected. Animal life, that literally global warming is ruining it for all life on Earth. And we're not going to be able to maintain ourselves as a species if we continue doing what we're doing. So I've been painting these things, and the first time I came into Marjorie's gallery, and I bless her for letting me into the Resist show, and that was my introduction to her, that Sunday morning. And Marjorie called me about 11 o'clock in the morning, and she said, Nancy, I have to tell you this, I said, why? And I hardly knew her at that point. And she said, well, I hung your painting last night, and this morning I heard about the glacier that broke off the side of Delaware. I said, yes, I heard it. And she said, and I went down and I looked at your painting, and I think I cried. Mm-hmm. And that was terrific to me. You know, I am literally painting what's happening. I'm affecting people's emotions. You know, if I could affect the emotions of the people who unfortunately are legislating as to what happens, that would be great. But, you know, I believe in the power of artists, but not to people who are totally ignoring what's going on in the world. My power only goes so far. But that's sort of my mission at this point, that I think that as an artist, I'm integrally tied to the earth. As a mother, I'm integrally tied to the earth. There's a reason we call it Mother Earth, I mean, obviously. And I'm trying to do everything in my power to do the only thing that artists can do, and that's make people aware. Mm-hmm. Say, hey, look what's happening. I'm trying to show you. That's what I'm trying to do. Thank you.
Retired psychologist. I spent 40 years in Illinois beyond that. My entire adult career has been private practice. As I was contemplating retirement, I knew from my education as a psychologist that people who retire and don't have anything to go to wither and die. And I did not want that to happen to me. So I spent about 5 years or longer dallying and this and that and the other thing to see what would pique my interest and keep my interest. A friend of mine called me up one day and she said, Catherine, would you like to go with me on Saturday to the Parks and Rec Department? They're having a collage class. And I thought, oh, okay, that sounds like a fun way to, fun day to spend a Saturday and some time with her. But I was pretty convinced that collage was for grade school children, leftover hippies, and inpatient psychiatric programs. Little did I know that collage is actually a fine art and was started by Picasso in a few of his friends. 5 minutes into the class, I realized that, okay, I'm about to retire. That must mean I'm a grown-up. Now I know what I want to do when I'm a grown-up. I want to be a third grader. I want to play with paper and scissors and glue and paint. This was the first thing that not only grabbed my interest, but maintained my interest. But I knew that I didn't want the traditional flat paper collage. I wanted texture. I wanted depth of layers. Not just paper on top of paper, but actual layers. So I spent a lot of time on the internet for about a year, cruising around trying to find another artist that did the kind of work that I wanted to do. And I found Gunther Rees, who was a friend of Marjorie. I were invited to Gunther's studio in Arizona, Gold Canyon, Arizona, and we spent 3 days alone just with Gunther in his studio. He taught me about ragboard. He taught me about depth. I taught him about texture. And this is what's now coming out of my studio most of the time. I do a lot of windows, a lot of doors. This one is called Roadmap to America because behind the glass here is a roadmap. There is real glass in the window as well as the glass covering the artwork. Everything that you see in here, other than the glass, is made from paper. It's on ragboard and then it's created on ragboard as well. Ragboard is 100% cotton. I tend to think of it as old dirty shirts, all compacted and sanitized. So I told her my title and I told her it was related to my art. I had the privilege for 40 years of people allowing me to see the most intimate parts of their lives, to see in the windows of their soul, behind the doorways in their homes. Haven't you ever driven around at night and the lights are on and you look to see if you can see what's going on in somebody's house or what it looks like because you're curious? I think we've all probably done that to some degree or another. So my work is reflective of the work that I did for 40 years in that there are windows and doors and you're allowed to see what's going on behind them. It's also reflective in that the shutters that I put on frequently are askew, or they're broken. The glass occasionally is broken. Sometimes it's got scratches around it. Because nothing in our lives is perfect. None of us sitting here is perfect. You're not supposed to be. And I think there's great beauty in imperfection in your reality.
I could purchase the blocks of encaustic paint at an art store, right? Or I can make it myself. So I like, these are small compared to what I like to do, right? So it's more economical for me to learn how to make it myself. So I make my own paints, right? So I heat the beeswax, right? So you can imagine beeswax. And then the pigment, add the pigment like hot chocolate and stir it up, and I've got a color. So I have to do that for every color. These aren't necessarily a lot of colors, but there are half colors. This one is on glass, right? And this one also is on glass. So I color the glass. It's greenhouse grade glass, so it's not like thin, so it's going to be sturdy. And I spray like paint on the back of it, so it'll still have some reflective quality, so I don't cover the whole ground with the beeswax. I've been doing encaustic for a little over 17 years now. I used to do watercolor and oil and also acrylics, and even back then I would make my own acrylic paint. I just like the process. I'm originally from Trinidad, so I like the heat. I don't mind the heat. And doing encaustic is like being in the kitchen, because you have to heat everything up. You can't paint it when it's hard, like right, trying to paint with a candle, right? No, you have to melt it and then keep it melted and keep it melted. And so for each color that you see here, I have to actually use a heat gun, which is like a high powered blow dryer, and heat it so it can meld with the other color. So that's what encaustic means, burn again. So everything that you see here has to be heated again and again and again. And you have to, so the art of this is actually controlling the force of air. So I love that. Now, I usually do mostly abstract work, but this year and last year, I kept getting visions of birds. Birds. I was like, okay, I'll paint birds. Okay. So I just, and I read a lot. So I was reading all about birds and how, you know, back in the old days, there were like actually really giant birds who were like the guardians of children, right? And they would like catch them when they would go over cliffs and things like that. And I was like, yeah, that's what I feel like. I feel like a big bird on the wing. So I did a painting like that. It's not here. It's in another one of Marjorie's shows. But this one, for this feminist show, this one is a female kingfisher. Now, it's interesting that the female bird of the kingfishers has to be more decorative looking than the male birds, right? It's the other way around usually, right? But this one, the girls get to dress up, right? Right? So what I did is what I love to do, a little bit of abstract, right, together with this orb, which I love cosmology. So I brought this just to show you. This is what I usually, the kind of stuff that I do. It's like feeling what's inside. And why cosmology is I dream a lot of traveling. So I figured birds is not bad for me to paint birds, because birds do fly. And one of our friends in Colonial Beach calls me Birdie. So I said, Birdie? I do. I feel like a bird. Or Flighty, because I'm always rushing here and there. So this is Eagle Eyes. This is probably the most serious painting I've ever done. One of the other artists talked about, you know, being really detailed, right? Who was it? Right, detailed. This is not detailed, right? This is like, but you have the feeling, right, of the bird. Yes. But the thing that I spent most of the time staring at those eyes. I kept looking at, no, it's gotta move over here, gotta move over there, looking. So half the time I'm painting, I'm actually experiencing what I'm painting. Here, again, with the orb, just feeling, because I do dream a lot about the cosmos, I do dream a lot about the stars and the planets, and I come back, oh, I remember that canyon or whatever it was, and I fill it out and I put it. So for me, I really enjoy letting people experience what I experience as a person, as a soul, as a spirit, right? In this universe, how can you share what you experience as a spirit other than, for me, through the painting or through music? I love music too, but this is a little easier for me to do.